Hello, everybody, everybody. Hello, we back once again in the house. Here we are, 50 up, where we got 1 hour to 50 up. 1 hour to 50 up. But before we get into the conversation, which we topic, we're going to be talking about death. Don't run away. We're going to talk about death. You can't run from it. Part of life. But before we get into it, I'm going to go around the table and talk to my co-host, Apostle Tulsi Wally. What's going on, Apostle?
Well, this is a day the Lord has made, and I'm rejoicing. I'm glad. I'm thankful to be in it and to see what he has in store for us.
Amen, amen. And another co-host in the house, Pastor Clarence. What's going down?
How you doing, Pastor T.C.?
Good, good.
As always, it's a pleasure to be here. Just want you to know also that you have our deepest sympathy and condolences for the passing of your brother.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And you from Church on the North Coast, y'all. And last but least, my buddy, my power minister, Scott. Peter Scott O.D. Wally. What's up, brother, man?
Good morning, everyone. I share the same that Pastor Clarence just said. Our hearts go out to your family.
Thank you.
Losing your brother.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And y'all know Scott and his wife, Alfreda, they came and gave us an A selection. They can sing and they do wonderful together. He played the organ, the sax, the drums, the guitar. He like Prince. He play them all. You know, the Bible said give honor where honor is due, you know. And good brother. Love him. Love him. But let's get into the topic. Death. You know, I didn't want to talk about death. A lot of times, people don't want to talk about death. I just had death in the family. I just eulogized my brother's funeral Saturday. That was pretty tough, but God helped me get through it, and support from you guys, my friends. The prayers of the righteous avail much, and I thank you for the prayers. I have a good support team. A lot of people is praying for me, so I just want to thank everybody for that, first of all. Now, death. A lot of people don't understand death, don't want to deal with death. It's sort of disturbing to talk about death. But death is part of life. It's part of life. You can't have life without death. And we don't know when it comes. Sometimes we might know when it's come, or how tragic it could be, or how peaceful it could be, you know. But one day, we all will see death unless you go in a rapture. If you're a Christian, we believe that rapture will take place one day. If you're there then, and you're on the right side of the Lord, you may go, but if you're on the wrong side of the Lord, just say hello to the world. Again, that's the only thing I can tell you. But how can we deal with death? Anybody want to jump in? What y'all think about death? What y'all think about death? We could talk about what you think about, what the Bible say, what really happening, how people receive it. And you know, by we getting older, what you think about death? Yeah.
Okay, usually Pastor Tulsi is, we push him out there first. we want to get that wisdom. We want to get that wisdom.
That wisdom, dumb nuggets.
Yeah. Yeah. We're waiting for him. So I'll step out. One of the things that I've learned is that death was God's idea. He was the first one to mention it.
Yeah, that's true.
He said,
that's true.
The day you eat of this fruit, you shall surely die. So God brought that in onto the scene. Okay, so we know that death happens to every man now because of the sin of Adam and Eve. So, but God saw fit to do something about the sin that man committed and brought on the curse of death. He did something about that. So judicially, he sent his son to take the judgment that was due us. So judicially, we have been set free. The price has been paid. But there is something else that goes with that, and that's the experimental part of the salvation. And so salvation has, we have to accept the judgment that happened to us, that Christ gave for us. His incarnation, he paid the price for us. That's an awesome God that he did that.
Yeah, I agree.
He paid the price for us. We couldn't pay it. We can't pay it right now. So So death for us is, it doesn't affect us.
Now, I'm going to ask you a question because I know the answer, but some people may not know. How did he pay that price?
How did God pay the price for death?
Yeah.
Okay, first of all, through the incarnation. Okay, he became man. He came, he took our sins, gave us his righteousness, went to the cross, and paid the penalty that we were supposed to pay.
Yes.
Okay, and then after that happened, then something awesome happened because he was raised from the dead. He was resurrected.
Yes.
And because of the resurrection, we don't have to worry about death anymore.
Amen. Amen. Anybody else?
Well, I think when we talk about death, there are two aspects of death that we have to be mindful of. There is a spiritual death, which is separation from God, and there's a physical death, and that's death of the body. Pastor Clarence made reference to the fact that God said to Adam, the day that you eat of this forbidden fruit, you will surely die. Now, Adam did in fact die the day he ate. And that was a spiritual death of separation from God. But he lived in his human body hundreds of years after that. So when we talk about death, there are two levels of death that we have to be sensitive to, because we have dead men walking around today.
Yeah, yeah.
Because if you're separated from God and have not experienced the life that Jesus brought, then you are a dead man walking, because Jesus, as Pastor Clarence clearly explained, paid the penalty for us. See, Adam died spiritually the day he ate of the fruit. Jesus restored that spiritual connection with God the Father. Yes. So that spiritual life came back to us through Jesus. And the only way we can have that life, which is the life of Christ, is by accepting Jesus Christ as our personal Savior.
Amen.
Okay. Scott, what you think? Spiritual, physical, whatever.
I agree with both pastors. Mm-hmm. An ordinary person on the street that is afraid of death. I mean, Christians, you know, they know, they understand, they identify with the meaning of death. But an ordinary guy walking down the street, that's an ordinary female, you know, who are afraid of death. And they are great leaders. You know, the Egyptians were afraid of death. The pharaohs were afraid of death. I think because it is something that no one can control. No one can control death. Right. Death is like getting old. You can do everything with your body, but you're going to get old. You can have all this surgery and, you know.
Yeah,
you know,
that's true.
It's a fascinating thing that God created, death and life and old age. You know, great leaders in the Bible were young, and David was young. He was vibrant. He got old. Saul was young. He was vibrant. He got old. You know, Samuel was young, vibrant. He got old. So I think people can't control death. That a lot of scientists have tried many years. They tried to do experimental things on with animals, but you can't control death. You just can't. You can sustain a person to live for a longer period of time, but he or she going to die. So people are afraid of that, which they don't have control over. They don't understand. You know, people are afraid of, like the Muslims coming to take over our country. The Mexican, I don't understand you, I don't have a clear understanding, I'm going to be afraid of you. You know, so I think the ordinary guy on the street, only a person who is not embedded in their faith, you know, they are afraid of death because they don't have control. If we have control over death, people will not be afraid of death. Oh, he just died. Don't worry, I'll bring him back this evening. I'll let him sleep for 2 minutes, but maybe 5 hours, because I couldn't stand him. You know, maybe next week we'll bring him back to life. Even Jesus cried when his best friend died. But Jesus was different because he had power over death, you know. But
you know what? Why do we fear death? A lot of people like, I'm afraid of death. And you know, it's like, it's normal, I guess. But why are we so afraid? But yet there's a small group of people, a radical Muslim who will kill themselves and not afraid of death. But somebody put a gun, oh, I'll do anything you say. Or somebody put a knife, oh, I'll do anything. But why is like we're afraid of death? It could be many reasons why we're afraid of death. Anybody want to talk about that?
Like I said, we don't have control over it. You know, we don't have control.
You know, I think part of it is that we don't understand what eternal life is. I want to make 2 points. Mm-hmm. First, everybody has eternal life.
Yes.
Because we are a spirit. We have a soul, we live in a body. Everybody has eternal life. So when the physical body dies, that's not the cessation or end of life. I don't care whether you're saved or unsaved. Mm-hmm. Now, everybody is going to spend eternity someplace. Now, the question is whether you're going to spend eternity with God Almighty, our Father, or with Satan, your father. Remember, Jesus said to the Pharisees once, you are of your father, the devil.
Yeah.
Now, when we die in this physical body, when we take our last breath in these physical bodies, we are going home to daddy, everybody. The question is whether you're going home to daddy God or daddy Satan.
Yeah, yeah, that's now, basic.
If we understand, and that choice has to be made while there's still breath in our bodies. Now, if we fully understand what eternal life is and that Jesus has taken the sting out of death, then we would understand that what we have is a life that is so full of God that even death cannot disrupt it. Mm-hmm. Even death in the physical body cannot disrupt this life we have, because we transition from one stage of life into another stage of life, and we continue living. Just because the body is dead doesn't mean I'm dead. This is just the house I'm in. I am more than this house. So just because my body dies doesn't mean I die. No. I am still alive, and I will still be alive because I have that God life, which is everlasting life.
Yeah.
So, because we don't understand that, we fear it. And I think what Peter Scott said, we don't control it. We don't really, for the most part, know the day or the hour or time. And as humans, we like to be in control of stuff. But we don't control that. No, we don't. But we can trust in the Lord and trust him. Mm-hmm. And that takes the fear out of it. The sting of it is gone. And we can rest in him.
I love it when Pastor Tossie starts preaching.
Got a lot of wisdom.
Yeah. I just want to support something that he's saying, uh-huh. Some of the things he's saying.
Okay.
If we look at Ecclesiastes chapter 12, mm-hmm. and verse 7, because he talked about we're body, soul, and spirit, mm-hmm. okay, which is true. And it says in Ecclesiastes chapter 7, and the dust returns to the earth as it was, and the spirit returns to God who gave it. Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's in line with what Pastor's saying, is the body dies, but the spirit, this says, it goes back to the God who gave it. I think it's also in Psalms chapter 146 and verse 7, And that says, Psalm 146, verse 4 says, when his breath departs, he returns to the earth, and on that very day, his plans perish.
I love that.
Okay, so what he's saying is that there are two kinds of death, spiritual death and natural death. Uh-huh. I want to add one more.
Okay.
That's eternal death.
Okay.
That's completely, totally, eternally separated from God.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so one of the reasons that people fear death is because they don't understand it. First of all, Brother Scott says the same, they can't control it. And it's also a thought process. It's our thinking. It's the worldview sometimes we have. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's the worldview that we have. Because some people think that we recycle.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
we die and then we come back as something else.
Right.
Okay, they call that reincarnation.
Right.
And you keep recycling until you get it right. Okay, now I never knew what happened after you got it right.
they didn't say that part.
But you keep coming back.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so it's a thought process. It's a thinking of a worldview that says that they have different views on what death is all about. Some people believe that when you die, you are annihilated. You are no more.
Yeah, that's it.
You don't exist anymore. Yes. There's no more penalty. There's no penalty for your death. There's nothing.
Right.
A lot of people believe that. I'm not sure exactly which worldview that is, but they believe that. You're annihilated. So you can do whatever you want in this world because after it's over, you're finished.
Mm-hmm.
There's no accountability for what you've done, your actions.
Right.
And we know that's not true according to what the word says.
Right. Scott?
Yeah, I mean, very true what they are saying. And so you were saying earlier why those fanatical Muslims, why aren't they afraid of that? I think sometimes when people know tomorrow is going to be better, they are willing to work today, sacrifice today. You know, people work hard and invest their money and put the money aside because, hey, by God's grace, when I retire, tomorrow is going to be better. So those fanatical Muslims believe that if I kill myself, tomorrow is going to be better for me. I will go up in heaven and have, 13 or 14
virgins,
you know.
Yeah.
You know. So tomorrow is going to be better. Drink some wine, you know.
Drink wine.
13 or 14 virgins. It's hard to take care of one female. You want 13 of them. You know. But then,
get a virgin.
But they're one of the best of things, you know. So when people know tomorrow is going to be better, they aren't afraid of today. You know, I will go out there and, you know, work hard because tomorrow is going to be better for me. Back again with the Pharaoh. They said, well, when we die, we need to take our servants with us. We need to take all these goals with us and everything because tomorrow is going to be better. So when people are not afraid of tomorrow, they are willing to do anything today. And that's where those fanatical Muslims come from. They think it's going to be better for them, you know. So, but we know what tomorrow is for us, you know. We know what tomorrow is as Christian. We know what our tomorrow is. Their tomorrow is different, you know. And that's why they are willing to do whatever damage today, because their tomorrow is going to be better. So we have to just continue to talk to people about, you know, the benefits of being, you know, a follower of Christ. You know, there's immense benefit in that. You know, we just have to convince them. I believe I don't know what century it was when they had the indulgence in Europe, and people were actually paying the Catholic Church, you know, to
pay to get into heaven.
And people were convinced because everybody wants tomorrow to be better for them. You know, if there was no tomorrow, I'm not paying or dying. If there was no tomorrow, I'm not killing myself with no suicide bomb. You know, but if I know tomorrow is coming, I pay the Catholic priest to keep my spot for me. So we got to convince, talk to these people that tomorrow is going to be better.
You know, we've been talking about death from a spiritual perspective, primarily.
Right.
And there are probably listeners who are saying to themselves, okay, all that's true, but what can you say to me in the grief and the pain that I experience when my loved one dies, when my mother dies, when my sibling dies, when a child dies? What can you say to me about death? Everything you've been talking about is well and good, and I understand that. But what can you say to me for the pain and grief that I experience? And I think we need to address that. Because we are humans.
Yes.
And there is that grief, pain that we experience when a loved one dies, because we have relationship with them, we have life experiences with them, and on this side, that does come to an end.
Yes.
And that can create a hole in our hearts, if you will, because that loved one will not be with us on this side anymore. And so there is a time of mourning. The Bible says that weeping may endure for a night, but joy does come in the morning. And so it's okay to grieve, and we do have the Holy Spirit to comfort us in that time. But it's okay to grieve. It's okay to feel pain. It's okay to cry. We want to, at those times, think more about the memories and the life of this loved one and the joy that we had with them, and let that live forever in us.
I like that, but I'll come to you a little harder because I just like to keep it real. I'm mad at God. I don't want to hear that stuff. You talk about this God. How can he be so good? When my mother died, my brother died, I'm hurt. Why he let him die a drastic way, a terrible way? So what can somebody take from this, from hurt and pain? Mm-hmm. And you're talking about, it's a God. How can there be God when all this evil happened to my brother, sister, a wife, or husband? You know, they suffered with cancer. They in the hospital. They did good, Pastor. You tell me, oh, it's going to be a better day. Joy coming in the morning. I don't see no joy coming nowhere. How do you deal with that?
Yeah. You're right. Yeah. And in the Bible, I think when that, they addressed Jesus with that anger when, what's his name, daughter died. You know, people are upset. They don't know why. He did. So I think a person, and you're right, naturally we get angry.
Yeah, we get angry.
My sibling died, you know, my mom died. But my dad, and some people never stop grieving. Some people go to their grave grieving, you know. And I don't know, I have not gotten to the point where I have the right word to tell somebody who I've lost the loved one, other than letting them know about Christ and everything. And like you said, people want, you can say all those wonderful things, but naturally people are still hurt. So I will probably ask that person sometime to yourself, how do you think your loved one lived? How do you think they did live a good life? I mean, be honest with yourself. How did you think this person lived? Well, I don't think they were all right. You know? Okay, so what do you think they, based on their life to live, where you think they may be going? I don't know. Do you want to go there too? Where they're going based on the life they live? So maybe you need to, you know, turn your life around to God. If you think to live a good life, you know we're going to die. That's, you know that.
Yeah,
you know, you're not going to live
can't
forever.
Have, yeah.
So if you live a good life, you would meet that person where they're going.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you would see them again, you know. You know, so that's something I at least try to talk to people about. But some people never get over death.
Yeah, because I have talked to a couple of different people in jail and out of jail. And, you know, I try to minister in jail. And I ran across a couple of people very upset with God.
Mm-hmm.
Very upset with God. They don't want to deal with God. Like, one guy, like, he let my son die.
Yeah.
Then I said, really, he didn't let your son die. He allowed it to happen. But sin allowed your son to die. The Bible says the wages of sin is death. I said, everybody living got to experience death. And later, you know, I'm thinking, Jesus himself had to die. He had to die because he took on the sin of us. And once sin get on you, you got death coming. And we are born into sin, shaped into iniquity. And so everybody born must die. Jesus was the only one who was sinless. But when he came to that cup, he said, I don't want the cup. You know, I got to pray about this thing. You know, I know we taught God about this. I know my job. But now it's here. It's just like, it's here now. I'm having a second thoughts, and I got to talk to you because he sweated blood. So it was detrimental to him to make the right decision. And it wasn't so much, he wasn't afraid of death. He wasn't afraid of death. What he did not want is that disconnect from his father.
That's right.
That relationship. It's all about relationship. And the closer you are, the more hurt is going to hurt you. But I know my experience is that my mama, my daddy, you know, we are believers. And believer in Christ helps a whole lot knowing that what you believe in, have faith in.
Yes.
And I have seen God move. I know it's the God. And some people may not have saw what I've saw, but God said you know he's alive by the things you see in the world, the trees, the birds. It just ain't come by no Big Bang. We talked about that before. Ain't no way a Big Bang go happen by coincidence and be perfect. You know, we right spot at the from the sun. You know, so my thing is knowing that, yeah, death will make you mad. It will hurt you. You have all kind of emotions and feelings. And, you know, when it comes knocking at your door, it's a whole different ball game. You know, and some people sometimes have death back to back to back. Like my brother died, and then a good friend came over. Man, I'm sorry about your brother. I said, thank you. And he said, I know what you're going through. My brother just died. I said, what? Your brother just died? He said, yeah, 30 days ago. Down at the county jail. I said, I work at the jail. He said he came in, died the next day. He said he had some ailments. He was like an alcoholic. I probably know. He died. I said, I remember a simple case. He died.
I talked to him, too. I talked to the guy.
Yep, so he came over 2 weeks ago, and we ate, watched the movie. My in-laws was over. I get a phone call. He died. I said, what? He was just at my house. He died. Had a heart attack at work. And I'm like, this is crazy. I'm like, this is so crazy. I said, so death don't have no time. It's the angel of death moves and it picks who it picks.
Yeah. One of the things that we have to remember is our perception of what happened. Mm-hmm. Okay. So, for example, my mom passed. I dearly miss her. She was so awesome in my life. But looking at it from a spiritual standpoint, my mom was saved.
Amen.
Okay.
Amen.
So I know where she went.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And if she had the opportunity to come back here, she wouldn't.
I know that's right.
Not where she is.
No.
Okay,
no, right,
so
right.
So my perception, I mean, so the way I'm looking at it is she was saved. She's going home to be with the Lord. I miss her, but I know if I want to see her, I have to do the same thing she did.
Confess
my life to Jesus Christ. Okay?
Yes.
And so anybody that's saved, the Bible says in 1 John chapter 5, verse 12, whoever has the Son has life. Whoever does not have the Son does not have life. So Pastor Tossie, in his first, when he started, began to talk, he talked about this eternal life, understanding this eternal life. And everybody's going to live forever. It just depends on where we live. Are we going to live with Christ, our God in heaven, or are we going to be with the other guy down in torment?
Right.
Okay.
You know, there's a scripture I want to share that I think sheds some light on this discussion. It's 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. It says, now also we would not have you ignorant, brethren. Now, ignorant simply means to be without knowledge.
Right. Mm-hmm.
About those who fall asleep in death, that you may not grieve for them as the rest who have no hope beyond the grave. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will also bring with him, Jesus, through Jesus, those who have fallen asleep in death. So, what the scripture is saying that, and I think that's what we have been saying today, we should not be ignorant and without knowledge of this subject of death and death itself, so that we may not, you see, I think, and Pastor Clarence just said it, there is a grieving when someone goes, dies, when someone dies. But when we know that that loved one is home in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ,
amen,
we don't grieve as those who don't have that hope.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
If you don't have that hope, then your grief takes on a whole different nature.
Yes.
And character.
Yes.
And if you are a believer, then you have no expectation of ever seeing them again, because they are not in the presence of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's grief. And that's why we must proclaim this gospel.
Yes, yes.
Everywhere we go. That's why Jesus said, before the end comes, this gospel of the kingdom of God must be preached to every nation and every creature.
Yes.
And the Bible says this of Jesus. I think it's in Hebrews 12, somewhere like that. For the joy that was set before Jesus, mm-hmm, he endured the shame of the cross.
Yes, yes.
When he was on the cross, he wasn't thinking about himself.
No.
There was joy. Why? Because he saw you.
Amen.
He saw you. He saw us.
Yes, yes.
See, because he was experiencing death, separation from the Father, we would not have to.
Amen.
Through him, we're going to forever be with the Lord. The Bible says this even, that upon death, the angels of the Lord escorts the believer into the hands of God.
Yes.
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 So Jesus had reason to have joy as he was on that cross. And it was that joy that he saw that allowed him to endure the shame and the pain of the cross.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. So when we know that we are in Christ, we don't grieve as those who don't have hope.
Right.
And that's so key.
Right.
I want to say this as well, and I agree with what Pastor Tosi was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus looked past the death, and he looked at the joy that was going to happen because of his death. If you remember the people when Jesus was being crucified, they said, if he be the Son of God, when he come down off the cross, then we'll believe it.
Yeah, then we'll believe it.
Because it was naturally. They were thinking naturally. So, but when something happens like this for us, we have to go spiritually. We have to go into the Word to see what the Word says about what has just happened,
mm-hmm,
and know that if our loved one is saved, then they're at a better place anyway.
Yeah.
Okay? And we can't know that really. I want to add that. We can't know that really because we can't know anybody's heart.
Yes.
We can't know if somebody accepted Jesus or not. Not really.
Yes.
We can lead them to Christ and say that their words are a voice of the prayer or whatever. We can't know what happens in here. Only God knows what happens in there.
Yeah.
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 And there can be such thing as a last minute acceptance of God.
That's right. That's right. That's true.
He could be in his bed in the hospital. And because if you notice, anybody that before they die, where are they looking? They're looking up, right?
Yep. Yep.
Okay, so he could have an end of life experience with God. God could speak to him, even in a coma.
Yeah.
He could speak to his spirit.
Yeah.
And this man in that state can accept Jesus as Lord and say, we don't know that.
Yes.
Because we can't see the heart.
That's true.
Which is very fascinating when he mentioned Christ on the cross. And as a young guy growing up, I always thought about the thief on the cross with Jesus. I said, this is a lucky guy.
He's in the right place at the right time.
This guy committed all types of horrible things in his life. And last minute, who is he out here kicking it with Jesus Christ of Nazareth? But that last minute, he tells the other guy, man, we did wrong to be up there, but this man didn't do nothing.
Right.
By the way, so just remember me when you go to your father, kingdom. Mm-hmm. So even he realized in the end that, hey, look, tomorrow is going to be better, Yeah. So we don't know, as the pastor said, we don't know what's in that person's heart, But
right.
There are people who confess, and that thief, as lucky as he was, I think he was the luckiest man on earth.
You know what I love about that is this what I saw in the Holy Spirit. It's the three main things of God that I see. And one was Jesus in the middle, and he represented the love. The thief who did not repent, it represents repentance is very important. And the other thief is forgiveness. Love, repentance, and forgiveness. That's what it's all about with God. Those three things. Those three crosses represent you got to have love. God wants us to repent. And he's willing to forgive us. And we will have that paradise that he spoke of. But you got to accept him as Christ. And to receive it, we got to do it by faith. Because that's what we walk by. We walk by faith. But, as I've been growing, I'm 59 years old, and I'm like, I haven't seen death, thank God. I came close to death. But what would I want to tell people as my last word? Because a lot of times we don't get to say the last word, because death, if you're lucky, you're in the hospital, and you're sick, you're going out slowly, you can't, but what is it do we want to tell the world or our family? What is it? Because sometimes it's like I didn't get the chance to finish.
Before we get to that, this occurred to me when I saw the title of this talk today and the name of this group, 50 and Up. And I'm saying, I guess we are closer than 50 and Up on that side than the other side.
So, yeah, we are. More than likely.
Yeah, more than likely. Now, what was your question again?
That's it. Because, I'm thinking that do we have to say?
Yeah.
Because sometimes death would come before we want it. And and did we leave something out? Something we did not say? Something we want to say? And I'm thinking about this talk show, and this talk show can help many people with...
Yeah.
I think that was a question. What's the name? The rich man. When he died, he said, can I go back and tell them, maybe I forgot something. But there'll be always people out there that will speak to others about things that we did not say. God will send somebody, he will send somebody. But you're right, what were we supposed to say?
Right. Because, if somebody came here like, you got 1 minute to talk. What would that be?
Yeah. Well, I think it's our legacy.
Yes.
How we have lived our lives that speaks for us.
Yes.
A couple of years, a year and a half, two ago, I eulogized someone who had been in our church. She was 100 years old. And I tried to come up with... This was awesome lady,
uh-huh.
And she did awesome stuff for everybody. And I, initially, I'm thinking, you know, if I try to talk about all the things she did, we'd be here a couple of days. But the Lord said, talk about her legacy and what she left. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. As a legacy to instruct and to give guidance. So I think how we live our lives speaks louder than a few words we say at the end.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah.
So if we have lived a life that reflects the life of Jesus,
yes,
others will see that. Mm-hmm. There is a reason why the Bible says, let your light so shine before men that they will see your good work and glorify the Father in heaven.
Yes.
Now, see, we are living epistles and we are being read daily.
Yeah.
Wherever we go, whatever we do, we can't escape that. So it's a matter of whether or not what is being read of our lives reflects Jesus or reflect our carnality and our humanity. So that's going to speak louder. How we live is going to speak louder to this world of who Jesus is than any words we'll ever say.
Yes.
Because, you know, quite honestly, the world think we're hypocrites anyhow. Yes. That we speak one thing and we live something completely different.
And it's true.
And they're not off with that.
They too. It's pretty much true.
Yeah, you're right, Pastor Tom. Yeah, you're right.
So how we live will speak louder for us than any words we may say to anybody.
Yeah, and T.C., Pastor Tom is right, because if you look at Rex Harbor or you look at Billy Graham, then you look at Mussolini, or you look at Hitler, how these different people live their lives is how they are remembered. But even Jesus, the disciples were afraid of death. When Peter saw how he was beating Jesus up, and they said, hey, man, then you follow Jesus? No, I don't know.
Not me, brother. Right.
I know him, you know. And they ran and hid themselves, you know, afraid of death. But when the Holy Spirit came upon them, they did not care who went. I believe it was Stephen.
Yeah, Stephen.
Stephen was glad to die when they were. Yeah. I mean, he was like, man, this the best you got for me, you know. So when you get to that point in your spiritual connection with God, nothing fears you. You fear nothing. Dr. King, you know, when he was giving one of his last speech, said, I may not get there with you. He knew what was coming.
Yeah, he knew.
And he was not afraid of it. So once you have that spiritual connection with God, you're not afraid of nothing. You're not afraid of nothing. Mm-hmm. And that is where God wants us to be, where nothing deters us from being in the worshiping him, you know. And like those disciples, you know, they went out, you know, they told the world, they went many places in the world, Asia, Africa, you know, Europe, and they left a legacy there because they were no longer afraid.
Now, let me ask this, and you know, there's so many aspects of death that we could hit on and talk about. But what about, remember back in the Great Depression, people was killing themselves because they thought life was over. And if the tribulation come, you know, and Bible said it could be a tribulation, then a great tribulation. How do we talk to people about tribulation and they wanting to kill themselves because they feel like they don't have no money, no food, no hope? What about that fear? And it gets so scary where they want death and should not really kill themselves, but they're afraid to suffer.
That's knowing today is... I know what today is. Now I know today is just done. So let me go to tomorrow. People that commit suicide say, you know what? I'm done in this earth. It's just, this is bad for me today. So maybe the next life is better for me. We can't eat. It's sandstorm everywhere. The entire world is going through struggle, you know, and this is just too much. Kids are dying. Family are dying. That's when people have given up to today. When we give up for today, we're not afraid of tomorrow.
Yeah, I just want to add this. I think this is really important.
Yeah, go ahead.
If a person is down in Lake Erie and he's drowning, and he doesn't know he's drowning, if you jump in to save him, he'll pull you under with him.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Because he doesn't know he's drowning. But if there's another man down there and he knows he's going down and you jump in, he's not going to fight you. Because he knows he's drowning and you is the only lifeline. So you bring him to safety. I think people have to know where they are so that they can understand that they need Jesus. Okay? So I would ask a question. Do you have any kind of spiritual belief? And wait for an answer. What is your understanding of who Jesus is? Wait for an answer. Because it's all on Jesus. He is the foundation for what we believe and who we believe in. And they have to have that understanding of that before they can say, hey, I got problems. I got issues. Because they do have issues if they don't know Jesus. And as Pastor Tossie said at the very beginning, we're dead men walking if we don't know Christ.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So, Tom, what you got to say if bad times come and they got no hope?
Jesus is still and will always be the answer for the world. Now, when we are in Christ, good times and bad times are irrelevant. As Paul said, I can do all things through Christ. I have learned how to be in want.
Yes, yes.
And I've learned how to be in plenty. I've learned how to be abased. Yes. And I've learned how to be on top. He said, I've been in hunger and I've had plenty. You see, when we're in Christ, and you got to understand who he is.
Yes, yes.
We're talking about Christ the Lord.
Yeah.
When we are in him,
right.
Everything changes. When the Bible says in Romans 8:28, that all things work together for good for those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Now, he takes the good and make it work for our good, but he also takes the bad and makes it work for our good. You see, we judge things prematurely.
Yeah, we do.
Just because it does not meet the criteria I have right now. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to define it as bad. Mm-hmm. But the end of the story has not been told.
Come on, bro.
Because God is able to take that thing, even death, that we define as bad, and work that thing, fit it into a pattern, the Amplified Bible says. Fit it into a pattern for our good.
Yes.
Because he's God.
Yes, yes, he is.
So, when folk be jumping off a building during the Depression because their money was gone, they didn't know God. They had put the money was their God.
Now
their God is gone. So why do I need to be around anymore? Let me get out of here.
Right.
Okay? So when we know the Lord, when we are in Christ, we don't fear, we don't have anxiety. The Bible says, be anxious for nothing, but in everything. Everything, you name the everything, you put whatever you want in there.
Yeah.
It's a blank.
Yeah.
Fill it in however you want. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything, every situation, every circumstances, with prayer, supplication, with thanksgiving. And that's so vital.
Yes, it is.
Let your request be made known to God.
Amen.
And then what you're going to receive. Yes. See, you when you're dealing with God and you know his word, you thank him before it manifests in the natural, because he's not a man that he could lie. He does watch over his word to perform it. So when you know that and you have presented this to God, you thank him for it. It ain't come in the natural, but knowing God, he watches over his word, he'll perform it. And then the Bible says, and you will receive the very peace of God, that tranquility, that state of being assured of your well-being and salvation. You'll receive a peace from God, the Bible says, that passes understanding. You cannot figure it out. It makes no human sense. That's the peace we get in God. And that's what we must be.
Amen. Pastor Clarence, you want to say something about that?
No, I'm deep, man. I like to see him preach. I love it. I'm in agreement. I agree with Pastor Tossie. And our focus can't be, you know, we're not really of this world when you get saved. Mm-hmm. This is not our home. Our home is, we have a heavenly home. Mm-hmm. So we can't afford to get too tied up in this,
yes.
In this world. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? We can't afford it. Remember in the pyramids, when a prince, a king died, they put all of his possessions in there with him.
Yep.
If he comes back, and whatever, his solid stuff's still there. You don't get to take nothing with you. Okay, once we out of here, we out of here.
Yeah.
Okay, so we can't afford to let this life, this short 80 to 90, 100 years, whatever it is, we can't let this control how we react and how we do things, because there is an eternity that we all have to step into.
Yeah. Scott, what you think about legacy? Because you always talk about legacy.
You want to respond on that? Legacy is always is very important. You know, Jesus left a legacy, and that is, you know, what, you know, we follow. Legacy is very important. And sometimes people make legacy intentionally, and sometimes people legacy is unintentional. You know, you just live your life, a decent life, and you leave. You left a legacy behind, you know. And when you leave a good legacy, people will see. I was looking at ex-president Jimmy Carter. And Jimmy Carter, when he was president, according to some, he did not do a good job, you know. You know, they claimed there were, you know, the economy was not good, and there was some type of terrorists, where Americans were kidnapped.
Right.
I believe in
Lebanon. Right, he was trying to negotiate
and he tried
the release.
And something went wrong, so people always blame him for that. But over the many years, we have seen the good work of Jimmy Carter, and those things have probably been forgotten or swept under the table. I don't know. And it is his good works that people talk about today, all over the world. That man has went almost every country in the world, helping people, helping the poor. So our legacy is something that is very important that remind people who we are or who we were, you know. And President Carter is that person that often I remember. I said, man, this man is old, and he's still going after the poor. He's still trying to make peace in you know, very trying countries around the world. And that's something that we need to, you know, to pay attention to, you know. And he was a millionaire. He's a multimillionaire. He quite just done what every other president done, just retire and went into hiding. But he's out there, you know,
on the battlefield. Yeah.
He created a legacy.
Yeah, you know, at the funeral, I told everybody, I said, what I see authors. Everybody's an author, whether you know or not, because we are writing our own book. Jesus is the author and finisher of our faith. But we actually get to write our own story. The way we live, the way we act, we are writing a story. And at the end of our life, Jesus is going to read it and judge us on that story. You know, I said, but the good thing is, life is for the living. I said, the funeral is not for my brother, it's for us. It's for the people alive. What can we do to have a better life? It's to reflect on his life and to reflect on my life. What can I do? I say to honor somebody's death is to live a better life yourself. Mm-hmm. to honor somebody's death is to live a better life yourself. And I'm like, what can I do to live a better life? You know, because quiet is kept, sooner or later, your story is going to be read. Mm-hmm. You may not read it. Somebody in a pulpit or a cemetery or a funeral home will be reading. Some such, born in this day, you go get your born, your date of birth. The Bible, Ecclesiastic 3:2 says the time to be born, time to die. You'll get your birth of arrival and your date that you leave here. And in the middle is stuff you done. They will put down stuff you done.
And then you get a new name, the late.
Yeah, the late. You become late. late. And people are going to reflect on your life. And you want your life to be a life where people will say, he made a difference. She made a difference. You know, anybody could cuss, fuss, steal, rob, be ugly, and do all that stuff. But nobody want to talk about that at a funeral. But that person that done it, they done it. But, oh, let's talk about the good part.
Yeah.
You can't talk about the good part without the bad part. You can't have macaroni cheese with no cheese. That ain't no macaroni cheese. That's macaroni. So a lot of times they don't want to talk about the bad, the good. I'm like, look. I told bad stuff about my brother. I'm like, I love him, but he was bad. He was off the hook. He'll cuss you out, do crazy stuff. And I'm like, I don't know what happened to him.
Yeah.
But God had a way of bringing it back. Like you said, all things work together. And the bad stuff, God, when he get to mixing a salad, whatever, he mix it up and it becomes so good. God is best chef there is. He know how to make recipes and make things out of nothing and put it together and make it taste beautiful. But he taught him, he moved in his life, and I saw the movement of his life, and I saw the change in his life. So I'm like, wow, he's ready to meet God. See, the key thing is, when you go, be ready to meet God. And you can't be waiting, think, oh, I'll be ready to meet him when I'm 80. Who told you you're going to be here till you're 80? You could be walking down the street, and the bus, you jump the curb, and boop! And you're like, Lord, I thought I had more time. So you got to start rewriting your story right now. Like, let me get this together. And it started with repentance and to change your heart and accepting Lord Jesus Christ to help you, because we can't do this by ourselves. Yeah, amen. So death is rough, it's tough, but when you look at it the spiritual way and you know God, it's something that's going to take you to a beautiful place.
Yeah. And as you're sharing that, and even about your brother, if we live our lives the way we should, reflecting Jesus Christ, then it will avoid a lot of lying at funerals.
Yeah. Man, you know, you preaching.
Absolutely.
I will give you a collection. Tough offer.
He hit the nail around the head. You're absolutely right.
we got to get ready to end this show, but we laughing at death because God defeated death and the grave. So I just give kudos and props to my brother, James Thomas, who passed away. I thank God for the 63 years. And you got to learn how to thank God for what he did give you. So we see you next show when we be doing something else, but it'll be 50 up time. See you in a month. Peace. Love y'all.
I thought Pastor Torch was going to ask.